Water Resources Minister David Littleproud. You've got a few other titles, but for reasons of timing, we won't go into all of them. But thanks for your time today.
Great to be with you, mate.
We've had the Queensland State Budget, of course. Now, you reacted with disappointment. You wanted more money for agriculture and dams in particular. You mentioned Emu Swamp Dam. There's $42 million on the table from the federal government, and you want the state government to give, what, $13 million to get it going?
Well, we took it up to $47 million. Michael McCormack announced another $5 million. The state government said this is a big budget for regional Australia. Well, let me tell you, regional Australia, regional Queensland, goes west of the Great Divide. The infrastructure that they're espousing in this budget is all up and down the east coast of Queensland. There's nothing west of the Great Divide. A $50 billion infrastructure program over 5 years, and they couldn't even stump up $13 million to create 700 jobs in a small town of 6,500 people. That will transform Stanthorpe, it will transform agriculture. And it just goes to show, this election on the 18th of May that we had federally gave a clear mandate, not just about mining jobs in the region, but also about drought-proofing our nation with water infrastructure and creating jobs through the creation of dams. It's never, ever been our responsibility to build a dam, but we're putting $3.2 billion on the table and we're asking states to come and get it. It's their responsibility to dig the holes and to fill them. And they're turning their back. They're looking at what's important to southeast Queensland and not what's important to regional Queensland.
So if we look at this money, which is what state and federal relations get down to, like it or not, a lot of the time, you're putting 47 out of 60 million on the table and saying get it done. If it's so vital, why not just throw in the extra 13?
Well, in fact, we'll continue to have conversations. We've put around 56%. The farmers themselves are putting 30%. So we're only asking for a small portion of this dam, an $84 million project, and the state government are not even giving us the approvals. Everything's been done, the EIS, the business case, they're on the go slow. And they're starting to do the same with Rookwood Weir. I mean, that was touted as being done. The reality is now the state government's now dragging their heels on that and they're trying to slow it down.
But are you saying you might just tip in the rest of the money to get it done?
Well, we shouldn't have to.
I understand that, but whether that's on
the table. We're going to look at options because this is the problem. People are getting frustrated out there. They want to see action. They want to see our nation being drought-proofed. And states are really abrogating their responsibility. We've got to ask the question, do we really need states the way they're going? Because every time there's something to be done, they use us an ATM when they need us. But when there's them living up to their own responsibilities, they go running for the hills. And it's time that the states lived up their responsibilities. We've kicked the tin for 56% of this. The cockies are putting 30%. Surely the state government, out of a $50 billion program over the next 5 years, could...
Right. Well, it hasn't so far. So it's on the table that you might just go, well, here's the final bit of money.
We'll look at all options because this is important.
The other water issue comes from arising this week. Companies buying up entitlements and then on-selling them for a profit, particularly as water gets more valuable during this drought time. Now, I know you've got the ACCC looking at this broadly. What can you actually do if they find wrongdoing here?
Yeah, look, this has concerned me as I've got around and done shed meetings with farmers, particularly in the south. 93% of trades are in the southern basin and around 14% of water entities that hold water licences don't own land. So they're just trading. This is a precious commodity. It's not like gold. This underpins our food security and our exports. So it's important that we look at this, we look at how the market's evolved since the states have freed up water and removed it from the attachment of land and allowed it to be traded. So it's important we get an understanding that the market hasn't evolved and the traders, the corporate traders, as well as the brokers. So there's also brokers in this that need to have some regulation around it.
So could you ban people from being involved unless they've got a stake in it, having that land? Would that be an option?
Well, we need to have a mature conversation because, as I said, this is a precious commodity that's not like coal or gold.
Right. So and then does that call into question, is there any benefit in having speculators in there? Other than people, if you're involved in there, you've got land, sure, go for it and decide what's valuable for you. But could you get rid of that speculator element?
Well, we've got to make sure we're calm and methodical about that because there's unintended consequences around the total market. So the ACCC, we're finalising the terms of reference as we speak so that they can get under the bonnet of this and make sure that farming families aren't disadvantaged in this and these speculators aren't profiteering at their expense and regional Australia's and the country's expense in terms of agricultural production.
Can I ask you, in a broad sense, the government has, it was released a few years ago, a climate resilience and adaptation strategy. Should that include looking at the types of crops we should be growing, given possible shortages around the country where there previously hasn't been? I'm not talking about one-offs, but a change in water patterns and rain patterns.
Well, look, this is what the Labor Party were trying to say, that they're going to tell farmers what to grow and where to grow it. We live in a market economy. You know what? Our farmers are the best in the world, and invariably the market will tell them through their production systems, and we are the best. And they do decide what is the best commodity to grow in the geographical area based on climate and water availability. Big government shouldn't be sitting over the top of our people telling them what to do.
But it's not necessarily just a telling them what to do thing, but a strategic approach. When you look at a couple of the crops that always come up, rice and cotton as being water intensive, you know, there are stats out there about rice taking up 11% of water across the country and about 4% of the value, which doesn't seem like a smart way to do things.
Yeah, and look, this argument's been perpetrated by the fringe dwellers that have relevance deprivation in the political system here in Canberra, that want to single out a commodity. The reality is economics drives what farmers grow, whether it be cotton or rice, on return for that use of that water. Those producers sit down and work out what they can get a return out of a megalitre of water. I used to be a bank manager. You sit around the kitchen table with them and help them work out what would be the best return.
But so could that, it be that's... a case of a certain area where for them the equations work out right now, but if you cast forward 40 years and take some various estimates that it might not anymore? Is there anything wrong with thinking about what crops would be appropriate in future years?
Well, we've already done it, and that's why we've seen the evolution of farmers going into cotton in my part of the world, in St George, away from wheat, because the return on a megalitre of water is greater on cotton or on any other commodity. And that will continue to change. Our job is to give them the information, and we as a government put nearly $1.1 billion with farmers into research and development to equip them with the tools of the 21st century to make those decisions.
All right. I want to ask you about press freedom. What are your thoughts on whether an inquiry is needed, and has the balance been achieved right now between security and a genuinely open democracy?
Yeah, look, I mean, freedom of press is one of the key elements that underpins our democracy, and it's important that we get the balance right and protect it. There should be accountability and transparency, what happens in this place and right across the country. Getting that balance right with our national security is something that has to be done in a calm and methodical way. And I think that the Attorney General and Telecommunications Minister is looking at this and how do we do that. We shouldn't rush into it, but we should have the conversation. I think we're a mature enough nation, and now we've got a government that has a clear mandate to work in a sensible way with the Australian people and the media and all elements, all stakeholders, to make sure we get this right.
Is it fair to say it's not right as we speak?
I wouldn't make that assessment. I think it's healthy to explore it. I think that's the responsible thing to do as a government, to explore it and to understand it and to make sensible decisions so there aren't unintended consequences. The responsibility of a government, federal government, is to keep its people safe.
What we haven't heard from anyone is the two stories in focus on the Afghan files and also on the leak that Annika Smethurst had, is what's actually at risk in terms of national security, apart from a broad coverall.
Yeah.
We haven't heard that argument. Do we need to hear that if these are going to be justified?
Well, that can be... In trying to get to that point, that can be a little bit simplistic, because obviously national security, there's elements of that that I'm not privy on. I'm not on a National Security Council. We've got to have trust and confidence in our national security agencies to be able to give us that advice and to work, and that's about getting the balance right. And that's why we've got to be careful and methodical in this, because, as I said, the sole responsibility, the primary responsibility of the federal government is to keep its people safe.
But and on that trust, I mean, everyone says, you know, you cannot possibly question what the AFP is doing. They've looked into two different raids that clearly were not very good for the government. The other one, the leaking of ASIO advice to do with a Medivac bill, they said they couldn't have a reasonable chance of uncovering it, so they didn't do anything about it. Why wouldn't the journalists be raided in that sense? I mean, why can't we question the AFP's approach there?
Well, when you say it's not good for the government, I mean, obviously, we work with the departments, within my own department and AFP and ASIO and those, they're held accountable by the minister but also the parliament. But when it comes to national security, there is an element of complexity that you have to understand, and it's not as simplistic...
Well, when I say it's good for the government, the ASIO leak was clearly advice that made the government's case stronger on the Medivac bill, and that's the one thing that's not pursued. You'd understand scepticism about that, wouldn't you?
I can understand, but I'm not privy to the intricate advice predicated on national security, would not want to comment on that. And no one should. I think we've got to have confidence and faith in our agencies. These are the best in the world. They are professionals that have the nation's interests at its heart.
We will talk again down the track. David Littleproud, thanks very much for your time today.
Good to be with you, mate.